Good morning, good morning, good morning. Oh, it's wet day. It's nice actually, it's very nice. It's like, it's warm. It's like, first day in September. So really end of August. We've got some more scorchio weather on the way, like 27 degrees. So, but everything's had a nice little sprinkle of water, which is really nice. So, these are the sort of days I'm going to enjoy when I retire, you know. Sit in the garden, watch the wildlife, watch the all the plants and animals and birds shut down for the winter. Anyway, let's not get too, you know, prosaic. Let's go. What I'm actually doing is schlepping to work, like I have done every other day since I was about 9 years old. Get over your side of the road. I'm just going to put my wing mirror in because there's some right idiots who come down here. Anyway, I hope you're well. Got back off holiday. We had a big cash flow crisis, do you remember? £7,000 out for tax. £3,000 out for our quarterly payroll, PAYE, National Insurance. We're left with Mr. Payment on the business bounce back loan. She said to me, if I put down that you're experiencing financial hardship, I said, don't you bloody dare. It becomes a self-reinforcing prophecy, doesn't it, financial hardship? You hear? The week before, you'll hear an announcement that so-and-so's shutting down and laying off all their employees. Then they've got a massive great hole in their pension fund, right? But the week before that, you'll also get some very typical announcements, such as so-and-so is having trouble getting credit because creditors won't give them any more credit, and they are thinking of laying off people, or they're closing down some locations or whatever. Yeah, slow down a bit. And you know for a fact that means that next week they'll be bust. And I don't know whether it's just because they leak the news out slowly or because, as I say, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Because if you're a supplier and you hear that so-and-so is having trouble getting credit from the suppliers and they ring you up and they say, can we buy some stuff? You'll immediately say, well, yeah, fine. You send me the money, I'll send you the stuff. And they're like, no, we want normal terms, i.e. 30 days, which drags on to 90 days, etc., etc. And then we'll be in receivership and you probably won't get your money. Hello, what's Mansfield's want with a... Hello, Ross. They're shifting all those boxes out of that store now, all the apple boxes. They're all getting positioned all around the farms. Hey, nobody's coming. Wing mirror. That's just... I've got an automatically retracting wing mirror. I just put the window down, put my hand out, and then I can pull it in and it retracts. So yeah, anyway, so what's up? I mean, what's been going on with you then? I had a chap in the other day, and with toothache in his lower left eight. I mean, like, you know, not your typical 20-year-old, but I mean, someone who's in his, I don't know, late 40s. And he started going on about how he'd not been to the dentist for 6 years and how he worked so hard. And do I work Saturdays? Answer, no. Oh, you know, because he finds it difficult to get into a dentist, so difficult that he hasn't done anything for 6 years. And you started using word like carries and stuff like that, and he had a polo shirt on and that, you know. So let's just consider signalling, right, a bit. Signalling. When a patient comes in, they are, you know, you are trying to find out things about them. And if you're observant, you can find out quite a lot, especially when you start talking to them, you know. And you find out if they're nervous, if they're, you know, just nervous because you're new, or because they're nervous because they had a bad experience in the past, or whether they've got a screw loose. Although that sometimes that's a little bit harder to ascertain. But also they'll be signalling things to you. So this little polo player on the shirt here is, and I saw it in my brother-in-law. My brother-in-law suddenly came into some money. He's you know, I mean, it was an astute business deal that netted him a few million, and good luck to him. You know, I'm not worried about people making money. I would say he just happened to be the right person in the right place at the right time, you know, which is borne out a bit by books like The Black Swan, Nassim Taleb's idea that, you know, the richest people in the world and the poorest people are there by dint of circumstance, insofar as there are lots of poor people who work harder than the rich people, who sometimes have done no work at all to get their riches. And that it's just like life's lottery, you know? You just happen to have a pattern at a time when that pattern then becomes stupendously worth a load of money. Or, you know, people like, I mean, there are genuine innovators like Clive Sinclair and people like that. But then there are other people who really just don't deserve their wealth because they couldn't do it again, you know? That's why, I mean, Elon Musk is the obvious contradiction to that, because he's a serial entrepreneur, isn't he? You know, what invented PayPal and SpaceX, the Boring Company, and all sorts of innovations, worldwide internet access for everybody, including ships at sea, can now make video calls back, and etc. etc. So he's become the world's ISP. But anyway, I digress. So anyway, the point was, my brother, when he came into his money, started wearing cardigans, which is, I mean, you'll notice that I don't wear cardigans. Never. I think I've probably worn a cardigan on fewer than 10 occasions in my entire life. And people know not to buy me cardigans. Because I do think they tend to be a symbol of advancing years and retreating ability to regulate, thermoregulate. So that's my bulk. My weight is my cardigan. I wear it all the time. So, and so he started turning up in these polo cardigans. And, you know, the signalling was quite clear. It was like, I've got money. I've got money. And it's the same with, I don't know, Dolce or Chanel or whatever stuff. People start, Christian Dior is a classic, isn't he? He started turning up with Christian Dior stuff, and then all of a sudden, or a Rolex. That was the other thing he bought, a Rolex. You know, which is, I might be lucky in a way, or I might have just missed the point. But I would never spend money on a Rolex. I when I was younger and perhaps knew a bit less, I aspired to have a Rolex. I did think it was a sign of that you'd made it. But then on the YouTube, there's a lot of videos about having your mechanical watches serviced, because they don't run forever, you know. They're very complicated. And part of their attraction is that they're a very complicated mechanical device that you wear on your wrist. And as a result, you know, from time to time, you have to put them in to have them taken apart and the worn out bits replaced and the rest of it all lubricated by some bloke with, you know, an eyeglass on that's 2 inches away from the watch. And I just don't want something that needs that sort of maintenance. And really can't be worn either, you know. I mean, this my next door neighbour got a Ferrari in the garage, and he showed it to me, and I said to him, you know, well, what's the point of that? I mean, I understand that you can sell them for the same or more to someone else, which is, you know, which I think is a good example of the greater fool theory, which is that you buy something that you don't really know why it's worth so much, but you do know that someone else will give you as much or more for it in the future. In other words, they'd be an idiot for buying it, and you were an idiot for buying it, but they're a bigger idiot than you, and so they'll sell it to a bigger idiot than them. So that's what they call the greater fool theory. And I mean, you know, they, perhaps people do prize these things. But something is valuable because it's useful and it's rare. Useful and rare. And although Ferraris actually aren't all that rare, actually, to be honest with you, and they're not all that useful either, because you can't take it out. You can't park it down the pub. You're too worried that someone's going to key it, or, I don't know, probably not nick it, but it's going to get damaged, you know. It's going to get, take it down the little road like we've got, and you're going to meet some lorry coming the other way, and you're going to have to pull into a hedge and scratch all the paintwork on it. And then the next bloke's going to look at it and say, well, the paintwork's not all that up to all that, is it? So you never take it out. I have actually heard it going out from time to time. Since I went to see him, I have actually heard it gurgling down the lane a bit more. So I think perhaps he's taken my comments to heart about it not being much use in the garage. You know, what are you going to do with it in the garage, you know? I'll let you out, Mr. Square Chess Player Mini. There we go. Crossfire. What's a crossfire? Mr. Loopy. He's having a race, isn't he, with that Volkswagen. He's certainly very cross. And his crossfire is taken off like a bat out of hell. So, this bloke yesterday, he's wearing a polo shirt. And he's talking about Careys. And so he's, you know, I suppose having read a load of Sherlock Holmes as I was a young boy, I'm like thinking, okay, this guy, he's a doctor. He's a doctor. He's fat enough to be a doctor. He's old enough to be a doctor. He's arrogant enough to be a doctor. He's using the medical terminology. He's trying to tell me I'm not a complete idiot, newbie at this. I do know that dental decay is called caries. Now, the funny thing is that that is about the extent of his knowledge. He knew the dental decay was called caries. But if I asked him about the mechanism of caries or what, how to prevent it or treat it, he wouldn't have had a clue. But anyway, but he's trying hard to say, you know, I want to be treated as an equal in this, which is fine, which is, I don't mind. So, apparently, not, so he's not been for 6 years because he's such a busy chap. He's disappointed in us because we don't work Saturdays, and he wants us to get rid of this toothache in his lower left eye. So sure enough, he's got some old temporary filling in there, probably glass ionomer, I don't know, and which is all you know, decayed around the sides and that, and the tooth's got some bone loss around the tips on the X-ray. So, I mean, you know, and it's not an easy job to take an X-ray of a lower left eye. It's easier when someone is just about to have the lower left eye taken out and they're anaesthetised and you can pretty much put the X-ray where you like. They don't care. But in advance, unless you've got an OPG, it's quite an art form to take a periapical. But we decided that it was warranted, and we managed to get an image of the routes. Now, the routes are favourable, but they're in quite close approximation to the ID Canal. And obviously, the whole point was that he said he didn't want to have the tooth out, he wanted to have it filled. And I said that, bearing in mind that he didn't have a lower right eye, and that he had all the rest of his teeth, that really, root treating a lower left eye is not something I'd recommend. And I thought, by far the cheaper, more sensible, quicker and more cost-effective route would be to have the lower left eye taken out. But he's like, oh, I had so much trouble with the other lower right eye, I practically had to give up my medical studies because it was such a nuisance, you know. So, he said, I'm tending towards deciding that I'd like to try and have it root treated. So I said, all right, that's fine. Now, you know, I mean, and it really is fine. I mean, the way you have to look at this is you mustn't impose your values on someone else, right? Now, okay, how can I put this simply? In the old days, and not so much me, but other dentists would say to a patient, they would come in and they'd say, okay, here's your laundry list, here's your recipe of what needs doing. Go downstairs and book in and get it done. And the patient wouldn't really have much of a say in that. And to be honest with you, they didn't really care. They didn't really want a say in it. It was only when, 20 years ago, somebody said, oh, these patients have more input into their healthcare decisions. That this concept of patient consent, not patient, we've always had patient consent, but, you know, like patient input was developed. Now, how do you reconcile a patient who knows nothing and a dentist who knows everything with an idea of the patient having some input into the decision? And the answer is that in many cases, you can't. The patient just says, look, I've got a clue. You just do what you think is necessary and I'll totally defer to you in terms of treatment planning. But in those cases where, and a bit more like him, where, oh, they've got a road there, so they can't be turning right. With him, it was more like, you're like, okay, then they developed this idea that you had to explain to the patient in words of one syllable that they would understand and get them sufficiently educated to be able to make a decision about their own health. Which is good, in principle, it is good. But then, what that means is that the patients will then start asking you questions like, well, what do you think I should do? And that sort of negates the whole thing, doesn't it? What's the whole point of explaining? Spend 10 minutes explaining something. And you know, at the end of it, there's going to be like a short pause and the patient's going to say, well, what do you think I should do? And then what do you say? So I always, inevitably in the hundreds of cases that happen, I always say to the patient, oh, I can't tell you what to do. In fact, the powers that be have told me expressly not to tell you what to do. However, I can tell you, if I was in your circumstances, what I would do if they were my teeth. And I always qualify it by saying I'm a dentist and I would go to great lengths and spend lots of money and travel hundreds of miles to save my teeth. So when I tell you what I would do, bear that in mind. That's my frame of reference. You've got a different frame of reference, okay? So I then tell them. So they breathe a sigh of relief because, despite the powers that be, they have finally got the answer from a professional, which is what they were seeking in the first place. And they can then decide what they want to do. Which 99 times out of 100 is what you suggested that they should do in the first place. Because as a professional, you have to put their interests first. And what's the point of, giving them a lot of autonomy to put their own interest first, if the very definition of a professional is to put the patient's own interest first in any case? All you're doing is wasting a load of time trying to train them up as a dentist so that they can, you know, they can do what you're going to do anyway. Anyway, this bloke said he wanted to have the tooth root treated. So I said, well, in that case, it's a technically difficult and specialist job, and I'm going to send you off to see an endodontist. He's like, oh, well, you can't do it. Which was, I mean, because, again, he made the decision based on his assumption that if he told me that he wanted it root treated, I would root treat it. In other words, as a GP, he's used to micromanaging things. And he's like, you know, I've come here because I want to save the tooth, and I assume that you're going to be the person that's going to do the work to save the tooth. And he was quite surprised when I said, yeah, actually, I'm going to refer you. In fact, I'm going to refer you either way, because if you have to have the tooth out, because if it's a close approximation to the ID canal, and the fact that you said you had a lot of trouble with the last extraction, which is putting you off having this one out, you're going to go and see a specialist either way, or a surgeon for an extraction, or a specialist endodontist for a root treatment. But they are there, you know, it came as a bit of a shock to him, because he thought that it was just a straightforward flip a coin type choice, and it's not. But what annoys me is that it doesn't matter. Whatever happens in that case, it's lose-lose for me, all right? And it would be lose-lose for you as well. You'll come up against a bloke who's a GP, right? Who thinks he knows a bit, knows the word caries. And if anything happens or anything goes wrong, or there is any difference of opinion over how things should have happened or did happen, he's automatically going to get the benefit of the doubt, because he's the patient, he's the victim, and he's a doctor. And I'm the greedy dentist who did everything for money, and I'm a dentist, and he's a doctor. So never mind about the fact that I got a 9.5 rate. I got a 4.95 out of 5 rating on my website based on 600 reviews. And he's got a 2.2 out of 5 rating on his medical website based on 60 reviews. He's still, at the end of the day, I'm on a hiding to nothing. So why should I even bother? Do you know what I mean? I've got a bloke there who's not listening to me, not taking my advice, and who's going to win in any dispute about what happened, and even if it went perfectly. But just because he's going to say, well, Mr. Watson said, told me to have the tooth out, and he took the tooth out, and I had a lot of pain afterwards, and I didn't want to have it out anyway, you know. So anyway, so he's off down the road getting a specialist opinion for 1,500 quid or whatever. And he can afford it, can't he? If he's a doctor and he's working 6 days a week, he's probably on about 150 grand a year. So believe me, that's, you know, I'm not on 150 grand in 10 years. So he can just, he can bear the cost of that, you know, he can bear the cost of that. Right, I think that's about it. I'll, we've got to go, it's Friday morning, and I'm going to have a nice morning. There was something else, there was another point I wanted to make about him, but I can't remember what it was. No, anyway, all right, no, not a problem. I'll talk to you later, bye. Oh yeah. This is the thing about working 6 days a week, right? If someone's not been in to see the dentist for 6 years, it's not because they work 6 days a week. It's because they don't like going to the dentist. And they put off going to the dentist, you know. You cannot, right, use the fact that you work 6 days a week as an excuse for not going to the dentist. So don't let anyone sort of blackmail you into thinking that if only you worked an extra day, they'd all come rushing in, because they wouldn't. My brother set me straight on this. He said you could work midnight on Christmas Day. He said you'd get patients. Whether or not you should work midnight on Christmas Day is another thing entirely. And I agree with him completely. I think it's all very well if you're, you know, I mean, he's working 6 days a week. He's probably trousering 150 grand, isn't he? That sort of comment is designed to sort of try and elevate them above you, you know. It's designed to say, oh, well, you only work 6 days a week, I work 7, you know. Oh, you only work 8 hours a day, oh, I work 12. Well, that bloke is not working 6 days a week because he's more brilliant than I am. He's working 6 days a week because he's less organised than I am. Either he can't cope on what he would get paid 5 days a week, or he's got himself in a situation where he needs to work 6 days a week, and you know, he's going through a phase in his life where a few years where 6 days a week is what he needs to do. I mean, I went through a phase in my life where I worked 6 days a week. But I'm sure that I've said it before, the problem with working 6 days a week is that, you know, you go home Saturday, you're so knackered, you're so knackered Saturday afternoon that all you can do is sleep. And then, you spend all Sunday thinking, oh, I've got to go back to work tomorrow. So you don't really enjoy Sunday much. And, you know, probably all the family's over. And perhaps they all arrive Saturday morning, you know. And for the first part of the visit, you weren't there because you were at work. And then the second half of Saturday, you're asleep. And so you're no use. And so it's only Sunday when they start thinking about all going home again that you're like, okay, what are we doing? You know, and they'll be like, well, you've missed it all. You know, you're asleep. So, also, if you work 6 days a week, you can do stuff. I mean, presumably, he's in the 6 years that he's worked 6 days a week, he's had his car MOT'd and serviced six times. You know, he said he's done tons, he's taken holidays and stuff like that. So, he has done stuff. He's managed to get his day-to-day stuff done. He's managed to go to the theatre. He's managed to go to restaurants. He's done all the stuff that he liked to do. You know, all the nice stuff that we all think, oh yeah, no, I won't get around to the stuff I don't want to do today. Today, I owe it to myself to make today a nice, you know, enjoy myself day. And so things like going to the dentist and getting this decayed wisdom tooth sorted out, which is now a decayed and infected wisdom tooth, came up on his radar, you know, his 6 day a week radar. So, don't apologise for not working Saturdays. I mean, the other problem with working Saturdays, I always found, was that, you know, it was absolutely, you used to kill you psychologically if a patient failed to attend. You know, if you had somebody, let's say, I don't know, I mean, you know, worst case scenario, you had somebody booked in at 11 o'clock and somebody booked in at 12 o'clock for a couple of crowns, and then you're supposed to finish at 1. Well, then the 11 o'clock one didn't turn up. So then you have to wait an hour, thinking that all your villies are at home having lunch and drinking beer and stuff for the 12 o'clock patient, and then stone me, the 12 o'clock patient doesn't turn up. And what you've done is you've spent 2 hours at work then, really. Or worse still, you know, your 12 o'clock patient, you pack up and you start going home, and it's 20 past 12, and then the 12 o'clock patient turns up and says, oh, I'm sorry, I'm late, traffic's really bad, blah, blah, blah. Now, that wouldn't be such of a problem these days because of my famous take your money in advance and don't refund you if you don't turn up plan. So in fact, if I wanted to work Saturday mornings now, I probably wouldn't mind so much because at least I'd know I'd be guaranteed to be earning the money that I would have earned if the patients don't turn up. And you know, there's something nice about sitting there and knowing that you're earning the same amount of money even though the patient's not there. But, sorry, I've got to turn the windscreen, but I know it's annoying, but it is raining. So, you know, so what you've got to do is you've got to sort of turn the whole thing on the head when someone says to you, oh, but you don't work Saturdays, do you? You know, think to yourself, no, but, and the reason why I don't need to work Saturdays, don't work Saturdays, is because I am not disorganised like you are. You know, I'm not a out of control type A personality who works 6 days a week and thinks that makes me a martyr, and therefore, you know, all worship me. You know, say to people, like, take some bloody time off. You know, life's too short. If he wants to get sit in his surgery 6 days a week, and all he achieves out of that is a 2.2 out of 5 rating on the feedback scale, then really you have to ask yourself, what is he, you know, apart from the money, what is he achieving there? Certainly not achieving anything personally, is he? But, you know, having said that, I know for a fact that a lot of people think that earning £150,000 a year is achieving something personally. Let's get it in the right gear. That cyclist has held that lorry up for the last quarter of a mile. Bloody nuisance. So, yeah, so that's what I was just going to say. I was going to say that, you know, your life, I find, is plagued by people who don't have the treatment that you recommend. Don't come into the treatment that you recommend. Boy, that's some rain, isn't it? So, another case in point. A woman comes in today, 4-unit bridge, upper right, 3211. Hey! The upper right three is rotten off so that the bridge is detached from the roof. The upper right two is the Pontic. The upper right one again is on a post, and the post has come out of the upper right one roof, so that's detached. So that all that's holding the bridge on is the upper left one. So, you know, and I've given her, I've told her she needs to have all the bridge work sectioned and replaced and everything, and redone. But the only reason she's coming today is because she's about to go on holiday to a holiday home in Turkey for 5 weeks. And she's when I say light bulb, I mean some the sort of light bulb that you might get in a bicycle headlight, you know, some sort of tiny little analog 3-volt light bulb has gone off in her head and thought, hello, what happens if that bridge fails in Turkey? Well, I said to her, if the bridge fails in Turkey, I said, you've fallen on your feet there. The whole bloody country's full of dentists from what I can make out. So, you know, not a problem really, apart from the fact she's going to come back with all her teeth extracted and her mouth full of implants. So she's, her budget's not going to love that, is it? But I don't think it's her budget so much as the fact that she just doesn't ever agree to have anything done. Like my chap who's, I'm a scientist, Michael. I am a scientist. I don't want anything done. I know what you're recommending, and I'm a scientist. So don't try and have me over with your recommendations for brushing your teeth and everything. So, anyway, she said to me, can't you use some of that? She kept saying she wanted me to mix her up some 3-in-1 or something, which I presume is some sort of post-concrete. I know, 3 parts cement, 1 part gravel, I know what. Anyway, she was having a little joke, you know, because that's what she thinks it needs, some 3-in-1. So, you know, you have to say right from the beginning, look, I know you're making this up, you know. As it goes, you're asking me for something that you don't know exists, but you'd like to exist, that you've just made up. So I said to her, we can't do as much with glue as people think we can. The glue is a good glue. If the crown's a good crown and it's been cut really well and a nice impression and using a really, really good lab, which I did this morning, it's an upper right six. I'm so proud of my ceramic crowns now. I say to all my patients, if you've ever gone to see a dentist, you will need to tell them that that is a crown, because they won't know. They won't be able to tell. And and she's like, oh, can't you just? That's always the way they say it. Can't you just? Can't you just glue my denture together one more time? Can't you just fix my teeth together one more time? Can't you just do one more filling in it, you know, before you put a crown on it? So I said to her, all I can do is make you like an Essex mouth guard, a splint, that goes over you, over all your bridge work and crowns up the top, and you can wear that at night, and then hopefully then it won't be on the pillow when you wake up in the morning. So she thought about it for a bit, and she lied then. Instead of saying what you would expect a patient to say, which is like, oh, can you do that? Oh, that'd be great. Yeah, if you could do that, please, that'd be great. And she was sitting there thinking, blah, blah, blah. She's going, well, yeah. And when you have to explain something to someone twice, it's because they don't want to have it done, right? They're not stupid. But what I was trying to do is I was trying to get her to say no. She didn't want it done. Or yes, I do want to get it done. But she wouldn't either way. So in the end, I just sat her up. I said, look, do you want me to do a thing, or are you okay? Or, you know, you're going to sort of try and chance your luck without. And she said, oh, I think I'll see how it goes. I thought, okay, fine. This woman, right, who's got the effrontery to say to me, I have nothing but trouble with my teeth. My teeth are a nightmare. All my life, I've had nothing but trouble with my teeth. And I thought, yeah, all your life, you have been nothing but trouble for your dentists. That's what it boils down to. You know, you've never ever been on a sugar-free diet. You've never ever given up cakes, biscuits, sweets or fizzy drinks. And whenever anybody suggested that you have anything done, you've always said, no, I'll see how it goes. And that's why you're in the situation that you're in. All your bridge work's falling out 6 days or 9 days before you're about to go away for 5 weeks. And yeah, you're going to have a lovely time sitting around the edge of your pool in your foreign, in your Turkish filler. With your teeth, with no front teeth. People get themselves into these situations. Give me 9 days. What can I do in 9 days? Even assuming I can take and drill all the bridge off, clean all the roots up, that in itself is debatable, root fill any roots that need root filling, and then take a mould for a 6-unit bridge, which is what she's going to need, because she's going to need a crown on the upper right 6, crown on the upper left 1. And the rest of it is going to be a 5 abutment, 4 pontic, 3 abutment, 2 pontic, 1 abutment. So a 5-unit bridge, APAPA, plus 2 crowns, which you probably won't want the crowns done. Anyway, actually that reminds me, I must send her a quote. So I've written all the notes up, but I haven't done her a quote. So she said, no, I don't think I'll bother with the mouth guard. And I said, why is that? She said, well, because, she said, when I take it out, so I'll put it in the evening. When I take it out in the morning, I might pull the bridge out. The Essex retainer might pull the bridge out. And I said to that, well, it only happened the day it was going to fall out anyway. It's not like, you know, it's not like they clip in so hard they're going to pull your teeth in. But I don't want her saying that my Essex retainer has pulled her bridge out. So basically, all of a sudden, that then goes off the table as well, doesn't it? Because she said to me, but that is a problem, isn't it? Yeah. Thinking, I've thought of something, haven't I? I've, you know what, I've been thinking about this hard, and I've come up with a problem that you haven't mentioned, which is that when I take this retainer stroke splint out, it might pull the bridge out. She said, that is a problem, isn't it? You know, I tell me that I'm, you know, justifying my fevered imagination. I said, no, it's not a problem. I said, it'll only be a problem. It's only pull a bridge out that was going to fall out. And I said, you've just made that problem up. I said, I didn't say it was going to be a problem or even a possibility. And I don't think it is. But you've decided not to have the treatment on the basis of some imaginary problem that you've just used to justify your decision not to have the treatment. And so, you know, so basically, any excuse not to have the treatment, including non-existent imaginary fairy ones, is enough to stop her having the work done. Now, all the only problem is, it leaves me with quite a big problem, which is that you don't really want to be doing a 5-unit bridge under those sort of very difficult circumstances. On a patient who really doesn't want to have it done. Do you know? I mean, she doesn't want to have it done. She might realise that she needs to have something done, but the something that she wants done is nothing. She wants them 3-in-1. So, again, what do you do? Now, let's say I tell her that I recommend she have the 6th crowned, upright 6, and she says no, she doesn't really want that. If she can do without that, then fine. And I say to her, I can section the bridge that you've got and possibly keep the upper left central 1 tooth out of this bridge we might be able to save. And she's like, yeah, that's great, let's do that. So we don't need a bridge, we don't need a crown on the upper left one. So that just leaves us with a 5-unit bridge on 3 pretty disgusting routes. So, and the alternative is to just say to her, I'm sorry, it's come to the end of the line. You know, and we need to take it out and make a denture. Immediate replacement. So, but I think what I might do is give her the option of going to see a consultant restorative dentist. You know, which I don't like doing that, because I know on the NHS, when you don't like doing something, don't want to do something. And the problem is, on the NHS, the reason why you don't want to do something is because you're not going to get paid properly for the work. You know, your patient wants you to do something on the NHS, which they're entitled to, but it's going to cost you, say, £600 to do, that you know you're only going to get £150 for doing. So what you do is you say, oh yes, a specialist job, you need to go and see a specialist. What you really mean is, I'm going to make a loss on that, right? Now, I'm, as a private dentist, I'm in a fortunate position that I don't have to make a loss on anything. Nobody tells me how much to charge for anything. And even the fees that I've got on the website, I can modify if someone's is a complicated job. In fact, that might be the best way to do it. Just tell her it's going to cost her £7,500 to get it done. And then see if she wants to get it done. But I'd rather, you know, I mean, that in some ways, that's kinder than saying to her, it needs to be done, but I don't want to do it. But, you know, perhaps there is a consultant in restorative dentistry who might want to do that. And it would be able to charge her the £7,500 that it would take anyone to make it worth their while, you know. Anyway, we've only trimmed half that hedge there. I don't know why. Thank you very much. It's raining down here, isn't it? Well, it did rain, didn't it? So, yeah, so when I refer people, it's usually on the grounds of the expertise. I refer on the grounds of expertise. By which I mean, you know, my doctor, who I can't argue with, and if anything goes wrong, I'm going to be in the... I've got this lose-lose situation with him. So he needs somebody with some sort of postgraduate qualification, doesn't he? So he needs to have somebody on the specialist register, because then he's going to be on the... That's going to tilt the playing field back, isn't it, in the dentist's favour. The dentist will be able to say, yeah, I qualified at the Eastman. And, you know, the reason why it went wrong was XXX, or couldn't be done. And it's the same with this woman. You know, if she's gonna pay a large amount of money for something which at the end of the day she doesn't want done, then that's not gonna end well, is it? That's gonna end in tears, isn't it? Of course it is. Whose tears? My tears, that's whose tears. And we're not having that, are we? No, we're not. All right, sorry, it's a long one today. But I had to include that thing that I forgot about the 6-day week thing. So don't put up with any of that. And then I got rambling about something else. So you've got a 2 for the price of 1 today. All right, okay. Have a nice weekend. Bye.